Rulings, 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 and like, what's going on? It is, how can you live that way? Right? And that's a question that we are often asked. Why? Why did Allah do that? Why so many rulings? Why, Ya Rab? Right? And there are many answers. Scholars like Ibn al-Qayyim, for example, answered that in details. And I don't want to go through the exact details. But he answered different ways. And our scholars answered different ways. Certain people will tell you, you know what? You don't ask. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala la yus'al amma yaf'al. Wahum yus'alun. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not to be questioned regarding anything. Who are you to question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And that's correct indeed. I question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He does whatever he wants, I obey. So you do what he does. And that viewpoint, alhamdulillah, is good. But people, this requires strength. Certain people, that works for them. They're like a soldier. Ya Allah, you command, I do. You command, I do. Certain other people, when they take this, they tell you it's becoming like a burden. Ibadah becomes like a burden. Some Muslims are like that. You know, it's heavy. Is ibadah a burden? Is worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obedient a burden on me? Is that it? Some other people, they tell you, no. You worship now because there is a reward for it. Everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered you to do now, everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered you not to do now, you will see the reward of it in the hereafter in a way you never dreamed. So just be patient. And everything you do, there is a reward. You say, subhanallah wa bihamdih, there is a tree planted for you in Jannah. Don't you want a tree in Jannah? How come you don't want to say, subhanallah wa bihamdih? So everything you do, and that's in the Quran. And of course, that viewpoint is valid. There is no question about it. So everything you do is for a reward, right? As another group of people said, no, there is even a further concept. You guys missed the point. What is it? We were created to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create jinn and humans except to fulfill the purpose of ubudiyyah. You look to the tafsir, as we said يعني before, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said, أَيْ لِيَعْرِفُونَ. That the humans we are created, we have special ability, special capacity to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that even angels can't. And scholars went into details. Scholars discuss, this is Sharia, they discuss this, who's better, angels or humans? Allah made angels bow down to humans. Why? You know, like, I'm not an angel, I make mistakes, I sin, I have shahwa. They don't. Aren't they better than me? And scholars differed. And some said, no, prophets are better than angels. You know, like, now you have the fiqhi debate in the fiqh of the heart now, which many of us are not even interested in. But this is deen. This is deen. And they said no. And Sam said no. Among the sons of Adam, that there are some people that are better than angels. Why? And some of them, and look at the meaning. They said because angels, they have no shahwa, no desires, no ability to sin, right? They worship day and night. They can know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They know Him. And they know Him through certain attributes, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has many attributes, many names. Some of them are Jamal, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, right? Al-Jameel, the most beautiful, Al-Latif. And we love those attributes. And angels know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through that. But the human being is unique. For he has the capacity to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with other attributes. Like what? Al-Ghafoor, Al-Tawwab. Because we sin, because I make mistakes, because I slip. When I slip and I make a mistake, I know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I know what it means to forgive. You know when you're angry and you cannot forgive? Now I know what it means to forgive. Now I know what it means, at-tawwab, al-ghafoor, al-afu. Because I slip, because I'm incomplete, because I slip, because I do wrong things, through those things, I know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His attributes. Simple example, you wrong someone, a friend of yours, your best friend, and you know how it works. Your friends, and then one time you do something he doesn't like, and you wronged him, and you know that it's wrong. So what do you feel? Oh, I have to tell him. I have to tell him I'm sorry. But now I'm afraid. Why? Because sometimes when you go to someone and tell him I'm sorry, what will he do? No. After what you did, you do that to me, I'll never forgive you. And what do you have to do? When people turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they realize they wronged others, they go try to seek their forgiveness. And oftentimes, the burden of apologizing to a human being, please forgive me. No way. Go out of the house. Sometimes it might be your own mother, your own father. Yeah, please, please, I'm sorry. No. And then it becomes worse if you repeat the mistake. Can you imagine if you go to your wife and you do something wrong and please forgive me today, I did X and Y, and then next day you come, oh, please forgive me, I did it again. It will be like, are you, no way, right? And you would plead and really and get presents and do an X and Y and Z and such an effort, and you might be humiliated. You know what I mean? When you want to apologize and the person gives it to you and you have to sit and confess, yes, yes, and it is so painful. What am I speaking about? This is a way to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? When I see this and I see that this person, I'm begging, and he does not forgive me. And then I look and say, Ya Allah, you saw me slip against you. You saw me do mistakes. I slipped and I made this wrong thing. You saw it. You were seeing it. It was in front of you. And yet, whenever I turn back to you in tawbah, what happens? You do not make me go through this. Once I turn back in tawbah and see, Ya Allah, please, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, what happens? Allah is happy with you. He accepts you. He talks to angels. You know the hadith. Allah talks to the angels. Abdi, this servant of mine, he did this thing which was wrong. But he knew that what he was doing was wrong and he asked for my forgiveness. I make you witness that I forgive him. I didn't have to beg. I wasn't humiliated. And then next day, according to the hadith, again, the person slips again. What does Allah do? Tells the angels, my servant slipped, asked for forgiveness, and then slipped again. But then he asked for forgiveness. I make you witness, I forgive him. And then you slip again. And the same thing happens. And you know the hadith. And Allah tells the angel, Allah speaking about me, the one that slips to the angels, telling them what? The moment I, Ya Allah, please accept me, he doesn't put you through trouble. He accepts it, he forgives it, he loves you, he raises you in rank, he erases the sin, he makes the sin as a good deed. And I look to the human being in front of me, and I say, look at him. I sinned once against him, and he did not forgive me. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every time I sin, he's happy to accept me. Now I understand what ittawab means. If I'm the person that cannot forgive, sometimes it's we, sometimes it's me, that I cannot forgive him for what he did. And yes, I don't want to speak. Even rulers, horrible, look at what they did. Horrible sins, I agree. Horrible. And you find in your heart, what? No way I can forgive him. Can you believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can still forgive him if he turns to Allah? Yes, he has to pay. If you did something wrong, you have to repay for what you did to the servants. But Allah, just make tawbah. And yes, we have people that fought the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, killed Muslims. Once they say, La ilaha illallah, what does Allah do? Everything, white, everything is erased. So I know Allah in everything. But the problem is, why don't I see Allah in everything? Because my heart has veils on it. Ran, kalla bal, rana ala qulubihim ma kanu yaksubun. How can I remove this ran? I want to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to see him. I want to be able to fulfill that purpose. I want to be higher than the angels. I want to know him. I know him with my heart. But the problem is, the heart is not clean. And they tell you, that's the function of ibadat. When you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's dhikr. Subhanallah, subhanallah. It is like sandpaper. You're working, you know, cleaning your heart. The salah, the siyam is disciplining myself. Why? So that this round, this veil on the heart is removed. And then I get to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, that's the purpose of ibadah, right? And there is another group, and this is the point. Why all those ibadat? Why? You find it in the hadith, and this meaning the intent of sharia, the intent of all this ibadat, the intent of all what we're speaking about. Why? This hadith summed it, and I cannot finish without it. It's impossible for me. And the very well-known hadith, من عاد لي وليا فقد آذنته بالحرب. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like, it's a Qudsi hadith. And it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that mentions, the Prophet mentions, that he says, whoever declares animosity with one of my awliya, wali, you know what wali means? Al-qarib alladhi yansuruk. Al-habib alladhi ra'ak. Wali, Allah's al-wali. Allahu huwa al-wali. It's the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wali is the one that's close, that brings you victory. That is near, that loves you. That's And how can I take any other wali except Allah and the believers? Of course, wali is not friends. Can I take wali except Allah and his believers? Never. When you understand it that way, Allah is al-wali. And Allah says, whoever declares animosity against one of my awliya, الذين آمنوا وهم يتقون, those who believe and have taqwa, those are the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, there are special awliya. Whoever declares animosity against them, فَقَدْ أَذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ, I declare war on him. I love them. Those are my close ones. I love them. You know what it means for Allah to love? You know what happens when Allah loves? When I love someone and I want to express it, what will I do? When Allah loves someone, in the other hadith, يُنَادِي يَا جِبْرِيلِ إِنِّي أُحِبُّ فُلَانٍ. Oh, he makes it known. Oh, Jibreel, I love this servant. I love this woman over there. I love this young boy. Love him. And Jibreel loves him. And then it is called in the heavens that Allah loves this person. Entire heavens. Can you imagine a person walking on earth, every angel loves him? And he might be not known. Not known. And then it goes further. It is called on earth, everything around us, all the creation loves him. And Allah, this is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hadith, it continues, and that's the intent. وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ عَبْدٌ إِلَيَّ بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَضْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ حَتَّى أُحِبُّهُ فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ. And the hadith continues, you know the hadith. Translation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this hadith says, and my servant never gets closer to me, does not draw nearer to me with anything more beloved to me or with anything better than that which I made obligatory on him. Oh, that's it. Stop right there. Stop. Did you see what Allah said? What is the meaning of this? The obvious meaning from a shari'i perspective is what? If I want to get closer to Allah, the most important thing to do is what? The obligation. Salah becomes very important. I start with the obligation. Salah, zakah, siyam, right? The dearest thing, the thing that gets me to Allah the fastest is what? The obligation. But there is another meaning to it. The opposite. What does it mean? So the acts that Allah made obligatory on us are what? Are the acts that makes us get closer and earn Allah's love and become beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the fastest. Do you understand what's going on here? So it's as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looked and he knew, left to ourselves, we are not going to seek him. If Allah was to leave it, salah is not obligation. Many of us won't pray. If Allah was to tell us, siyam is not an obligation, you don't have to fast Ramadan. Many of us would do what? I choose not to. When I do that, I'm not getting the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah wants me to get his love. Allah wants a relation with me that's past rahmah. Rahmah's compassion. Allah wants love. Allah wants to give us love. And when he knew that left to ourselves, we are not going to seek it. So he looked on the acts that will make us earn his love the fastest. And then he made them obligation. It's as if Allah is telling you what? You have to earn my love. You have to worship is what? You have to earn my love. You have to enter Jannah. You have to come close to me. That is why I made it an order for you, Ibn Atala al-Sakandari, looking to this, and he puts it in his words. He says it in two of his wisdoms. In one of them he says, لما علم قلة نهوض العباد إلى معاملتي أوجب عليهم وجود طاعته. أوجب عليك وجود طاعته وما أوجب عليك إلا دخول جنته. عجب ربك لقوم يساقون إلى الجنة بالسلاسل. He says, expressing what I just said, he says, when Allah knew that left to ourselves, we are not going to stand and seek him, he made it an obligation for us to obey him. He dragged us to Jannah with the chains of obligations. And then he says, amazing are the affairs of people who are being dragged to Jannah, dragged to Allah with chains. You view it as a chain, and it's only the chain dragging you to Allah. So why, Ya Allah, Why so many orders? Why all this? Because what? Love. And indeed, the essence of ibadah, the word ubudiyyah. When I say ibadah in Arabic, what does it mean? Worship. No, not correct. Deeper than that. Deeper has so many meanings. And Ibn al-Qayyim says, ubudiyyah, the essence of it is two things. The utmost obedience with the utmost love. If you obey someone, but yet you do not love him, you are not a abd of him. If you love someone and you're not obedient to him, it's just a claim. You're not a abd. Ubudiyyah is what? You know when you love someone to the extent that I can't but obey. You know what the word adorn? You adorn someone to the extent I can't help but obey. That's ubudiyyah. That's the intent of Sharia. That's why when my kid goes to the university, what do I do? You know, and wallahi, raising kids, even secular people tell you this today. When my kid is going to the university, what do you do? Please, son, be careful from the dorms. Please, son, be careful from the opposite sex. Please, son, don't do that. Please, don't go there. There are so many. Why am I telling him? I give him a list, right? Don't, be careful. Why? He sees it as what? Oh, father, yani, leave me alone. But what is the essence? Why did I give him all this? Because I love him. And they tell you when you raise kids up, wallahi, today's secular doctors, they tell you that. You know when your kid comes, if you have a kid, and the kid, Baba, can I do this? If you keep telling him yes, yes, yes. You know, they said the kid grows up insecure. Why? They tell you the kid, this 2-3 years, he wants you to say no. He wants you to put a rule. Why? Because that is where he establishes, Baba loves me, I'm safe. If I'm trying to do something wrong, he's not going to let me. That is how, so your kids, when they come to you and they tell you, and they know, you know when they push the limits? They know the answer, yet? Yet they come and say, can I eat candy? You know that you can't eat candy before you sleep, but I'm going to ask, Baba, can I eat candy? No. Why? Please. No. Why? No. And they want that. That's good for them because that's their security. Baba loves me. He won't let me do something wrong. If you do the opposite, this kid grows up very insecure. There is no limits. He doesn't feel loved. He feels lost. And we know what happens when you raise a spoiled kid. What ends up happening? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He loves us. That's why through the journey of this life, the more rules and laws you see, I should be seeing it how? More love. He doesn't want to, please be careful from this. Please don't do this. Be careful, don't step here. Do it this way. Don't do it this way. It is what? It's love. Care. That's the essence of it. That's the maqsad of Sharia. Love. I can't miss on this. I cannot view Sharia and speak about maqasid al-Sharia and the intent of protecting deen and miss the essence of it all. The spiritual side. Our deen has a spiritual side. Our laws have a spirit, have a heart. Without them, they become so dry. And then you can't establish Sharia without a heart. You can't establish Sharia without love. It's empty. Now back again to the word of outward shara of what we were speaking about. We were speaking, if you remember, about the penal laws of Sharia. And last time we said, among yani, the things that we said, scholars divided those. And I go with the division of, not my words, I'm nothing. I just convey to you what the scholar said. Ibn Ashur, he puts penal law of Islam are 4 things. We know hudud, but it's not only hudud. Remember what we said last time? There are 4 penal laws. 1, at-taghrim. 2, al-qisas. 3, al-had. 4, al-ta'zir. We spoke about the last 2, right? So let me go quickly, because we don't have much time. Al-taghrim, what al-taghrim means? Al-taghrim, you know, when, if somebody comes and breaks the window, somebody comes to my house, breaks my car, is there a had for it? Lashing, cutting the hand, death penalty? No. Did Allah say, like, what should you do? So this is no hudud now. This is a taghrim. And Allah made it very clear one thing. In taghrim, there is one concept. Ibn al-Qayyim quotes that. That people are of 2 opinions. He broke my car, I should do what to him? I should break his car. You know this mentality? He broke my window, I should break his window. He killed my cattle, I should kill his cattle. He burned my crops, I should burn his crops. Right? So Allah interferes and says, no. No. And Ibn al-Qayyim يعني mentions, this is the way of the oppressors. In Sharia, when a mafsada happens, when somebody does something that's horrible, he broke your car, you make him pay for it. You tell him, get another car. You do not return, you don't reciprocate fasad, harm, with fasad and harm. Rather, you reciprocate by how you pay for it. You break a window, you pay for it. You destroyed my land, you pay for it. You recompensate for me. And that's the concept of gharama. You know, the financial, it can be financial in that case. Right? Except in one issue. And that's where now qisas happens. Except in one issue. Which is what? What about life? I can understand. You break my car, I'll tell you I'll take money. You break the window, I pay for it. But what if you killed someone? Because killing is a very high level. Nafs is something very precious. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to protect. Killing is very serious business. What happens if somebody killed? The debate that we have in the 20th century, capital punishment versus no capital punishment. And oftentimes people ask Muslims, you guys have capital punishment? And the answer we always give is what? Yes. And the answer of course is no. What? Oh, many people will be angry now. You have to listen to the entire thing. Qisas is not capital punishment. There is a difference. Why? Capital punishment means what? X killed Y. What happens? It goes to the court. And the case is X, not versus Y, X versus the state. Do you get what I'm saying? If I commit an act of murder now, the police will come and they will take me. And it's between me and the government, the US government, صح? Me and them. If the other person said, I want to forgive him, what happens? No, it's done. He committed a murder, it's not your right anymore. It's me and the state, and he has to pay for it. Certain states in the United States, if he's found guilty, what is the punishment? Death punishment, death penalty. And there is no way, khalas, death penalty, that's it. You versus the state. In Islam, is that the case? No. Killing is, first of all, killing is on different levels. If I kill by mistake, I'm driving the car, I was not careful, somebody stepped in, I made an accident, I killed someone. That's, of course, that's an accident, right? And you know, here comes the kafara. You pay the diyya, you free a slave, because I didn't mean it. I did not even intend it. That's the first level. The second level is what? What if I intended it? I was, somebody like said something bad against me, we fought together, I hated him so much, and they said, you know, I'm going to kill this guy. And I went and like I beat him and I killed him. That's murder, right? That's homicide. Now what's the punishment here? That person, it might have been a slip, he might have been an emotional, you know, burst. Somebody was fighting with him, he got really angry in an emotional state, he went upset and like he killed him. So what's the punishment? In Islam, see now the balance, al-qisas. Remember what we said, the purpose of hudud and penal law is three things. What is the number one thing? To take care of the society, deterrent. I need a deterrent for people. Number two, this is the most important thing. Number two is what? The victim. You must take care of the victim first. Number three, to reform the perpetrator. So qisas is very simple. Qisas, you get this person. And the state gets this person, right? And you would tie his hands and bring him to the person in which he aggressed against, you know, the family of that the deceased, and tell him, okay, it's your call. What do you want? He's at your mercy. It's your call. It's not the state, it's you. It's up to you. You want to forgive him, you can. You want to take money, you can. You insist on killing him, you can. So the choice is left to who? The people. So it's in the middle. You see that? You see this concept of qisas? And how many stories have, I don't have time, how many stories have we seen in our Islamic history? Many people, you know why many people can't forgive? You know when somebody wrongs me and I can't forgive, you know why? Especially men, because I feel weak, I feel oppressed, I feel I've been humiliated, that's why I can't forgive. So look at what Sharia did. Allah doesn't want me to live that way. Allah doesn't want me to live with this feeling. So Allah puts you in power. No, you're not defeated. No, you're on top. He's the one that's humiliated, he's at your... And in many cases, up till today, it happens. A person would say, no way to forgive him, never. And then they will take him. And the person is allowed actually to be the one dragging him. And he goes with you. And then at the moment the death penalty is going to be applied, that person says what? Stop, I forgive. Why? Because he saw now what? He's at my heart is cured. I'm in control, I'm in power. Khalas, khalas, stop. I forgive. That happens so many times in Islamic history. The third level, which is another level, which is like a hiraba, that's even worse. Hiraba is something else. It is not a, it's a person who, you know, like people that, gang members, that it's my job to take a weapon and go and threaten people outside. You know, if you threaten someone, give me your money. That's not theft. That's not theft. If you take money from a person by a weapon, it is not sariqah. The had is not the had of sariqah. It is worse. Sariqah is when you steal, as we said last time, in secrecy. But you threaten the safety of the public. You dare go outside and threaten the safety. This is worse. This is horrible. You're threatening the safety of the public, people. You're carrying a weapon. This is like, muharaba is like war. You're declaring war on the state. What are you doing? The had here, this is no qisas. It depends. Did you shoot the person? Let's say I didn't. I just threatened him and he gave me the money. Well, it's not only going to be your hand, according to the Quran. A hand and the leg. Cutting the hand and the leg. And you can see why it is so harsh. Indeed, it's intended to be too harsh. Why? Remember what we said last time? Deterrent. Because this has to do with the society. It has to do with the safety of the public. In Irvine, you don't feel it. But go downtown LA for the people that can't sleep at night. Go to downtown Dallas. They know very well what we're speaking about. They know how serious it can become when you have gangs all over the place with guns and you can't enter the area and people are shooting each other and you're not safe. It's war. So in that case, and you can see the punishment is on a higher level for deterring. This is had al-hiraba, they call it. So those are the three levels of qisas. So we said taghrim, financial recompensation in everything except in self, or if somebody pulls my eye out, right? In that case, I'm allowed to do the same thing. Body parts, humans, nafs, it is protected with the penalty of qisas. You either forgive, or if you will, do a similar damage. If he killed, then he's killed. If he cut my hand, then cut his hand. But anything else that's property, don't do the same thing. Do not reciprocate the same thing. You reciprocate how? Compensation. So those are the first two. And we said ta'zir, if you remember, discretionary punishment that's left up to the ruler, the judge, based on their day and their time. And there is one hadith that the maximum penalty of ta'dib and ta'zir is 10 lashes. It can't be beyond that. That's a sahih hadith. What does that mean? A person who didn't commit adultery. Let's say, and excuse me for the language. A person walks outside and he walks naked. What happens today? Is that allowed in the United States? Can you walk outside? Can you go to work naked? No dress? Freedom of choice. No, it's not freedom. There is actually law. Like, you can't do that. That's wrong, right? What is the punishment? This is where you can say this is ta'zir. This is left to us, the people, the judge of the time, to describe what punishment you want. Prison, shaving his head, 10 lashes, depending on the time and place, this is ta'zir. This is an example. There is no had for it. There is no really had. There is no ayah in the Quran that deals with this or a hadith. But that doesn't mean no had, meaning what? He's free. No, he's not free. Right? You can establish a punishment. A person that breaks a stop sign. I need a deterrent. Ta'zir, right? Pay. Make him pay, right? $200. You break a red traffic light, we take your license, right? That's ta'zir, discretionary and disciplinary punishment. And we said number four, hudud, and that's where we stopped last time. And hudud, we said they're actually very few, they're not many. And we said, remember what they are? You can categorize them in different ways, depending on the crime. This is one way. And remember, the Sharia is protecting five things: deen, religion, right? Life, property, intellect, right? And family. So you can actually view them things that threaten this. We said if it is life, if somebody kills, that's qisas, right? So killing, we know what's the penalty. What if it's aql, khamr? We discussed that last time. Somebody who's drinking, remember? And we discussed it last time. Sariqa, stealing, that's what? That's a crime against property, right? And we discussed it also last time. What is the meaning of sariqa, the hadd of it? We discussed that last time. The only thing that was remaining, the one that was left, was what? عرض, أمر, family. Crimes that has to do with family. Like what? Like adultery, for example. Like قذف. قذف meaning what? And this is very serious. When you start speaking about a woman, oh, she did this and this, this woman, you don't know her. She's having an affair with such and such words. Those words can kill. Those words that I just speaking that way, and if you don't believe me, we all know Haditha al-Ifk. What happened with Aisha radiallahu anha and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What was the crime? It was something that stopped the entire society. Aisha radiallahu anha was crying for 40 days. You understand what you did? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and people were fighting, and the da'wah stopped. It was such a miserable time. What caused it? When somebody falsely started accusing Aisha radiallahu anha and spreading what? Rumors that have to do with what? Honor. You see this concept? Freedom of speech? No. This is no freedom of speech. You're not free to say on people whatever you want that way. Because that has consequences. That has consequences on her, her husband, the society. It's your right versus the right of the society. And we'll favor the rights of the society. You can't. Unless you have a proof, you're not free to do that. And oh, but brother, we believe in freedom. In Islam, justice is above freedom. Ah, I disagree with you. You'll be free to disagree with me. That's why I'm a Muslim. That's what I believe in. Freedom is not above justice. You're not, as a Muslim, actually this concept of freedom that people think about is أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ أَنْ يُتْرَكَ سُدًى. Do you really think you're free? Are you free when to die? Were you free when you were born? Are you free? Everything you do here, freedom meaning what I can do and there is no consequences. No. Everything you do, you're not free. Allah gave you a limited period of freedom. But everything you do, you're going to be reaccounted for. Freedom? You're not free. You're not free. You cut a tree, Allah's going to ask you why. Why? Why did you do that? You insulted a person. Why? Everything you're going to be held accountable for. You are free in Jannah. Not here. And that's what the Prophet told us clearly. الدُّنْيَا سَجْنُ الْمُؤْمِنِ وَجَنَّةُ الْكَافِرِ. Life of this world is what? The prison of the believer. This is a prison, man. And yet, Allah is so generous that the prison looks the way you see. Out of His generosity, it is so nice. But don't be fooled. It is not Jannah. It's not I can eat and drink and do whatever I want. Not here. This is not yours. So justice is above it. I make qadf, I slander someone. What is the punishment for that? Remember what we said last time? What we said last time, interestingly enough, in our Sharia, that, and this is something really beautiful, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala differentiates. Says the citizens of this state have citizens, right? Citizens are different. They're not the same. There are Muslims that are citizens, and there are non-Muslims that are citizens, but they're not equal. Meaning what? Certain rules, yani here in the United States, I won't say Muslim so that people don't take us against somebody who has a religion, a Mormon, he wants to marry three. What happens? It's a crime. Right? It's a crime. You can't do that. Why? Because it's the state law. The state law is applied uniformly on everyone. In Islam, that's not fair. He doesn't believe it's haram. So a Muslim and a non-Muslim are not equal. They don't believe in the same things. Another example, the state and citizens. All citizens serve in the army. But wait, what if my religion, what if somebody, his religion tells him, do not fight, do not kill. I'm a citizen, but I don't believe, I'm not allowed to kill. I can't. I don't want to be in the army. No, you're a citizen. You have to go to the army. I don't believe in this war you're fighting. The motive for it is not in harmony with my belief. I don't want to go there. Are you a US citizen or not? Are you an Egyptian citizen or not? Yes, you have to go. But that's unfair. So in Islam, look at the concept. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, people are different. So there is Muslims that believe in this, believe in Islam, believe in Allah, believe in His Messenger, believe in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, right? There are laws for them. But there are people living with them, living among them, that are not Muslims. So what happens? Those are called dhimmi. We discussed that last time. A dhimmi meaning what? A person with covenant, a person that's safe, a citizen that lives with a Muslim, but Islam identifies he's a non-Muslim. The laws are different. So when it's time to fight, I can't ask him to fight the war a Muslim would fight. Why? He might believe differently. He might believe, he doesn't want to. The Muslim nation declares, you know, it's our duty to help the brothers in such kind of a state. We're going to send the army to help them. This person says, I have nothing to do with them. I'm Egyptian. I don't want to go there. I don't want to fight for them. I don't want to. I can't make him. So therefore, you can tell immediately, for a dhimmi serving in the army, I can't ask him to do that. Yet he needs protection. We have to protect him. He's one that's safe. So we offer him protection, yet he does not serve in the army. Because he's a dhimmi. He can choose, actually. And according to many scholars, it's his choice with conditions. If he wants to serve, it's up to him. If there is a battle that people are invading his and he wants to his house and he wants to contribute, okay. But then the way you treat them, they're different. Which means what? The concept of law and everyone is equal. That can be also unfair. Example of taxes. I don't believe that I should be taxed 40%. I'm here by the Shari'i law. I agreed I have to pay it. But that's not fair. What does Sharia do? For Muslims, they believe in zakah. You pay 2.5%, right? For a non-Muslim, you don't believe in zakah. So what do we do? But they don't contribute anything to the society. They don't serve in the armed forces. They don't pay anything. What do we do? Then the concept comes of jizya. For a non-Muslim, he pays jizya. And many people hear this word and, oh, that's so bad. So bad. Jizya, what does it mean? Actually, I wish I was to pay jizya in the United States. Why? Do you know what it means for a non-Muslim? First of all, jizya is not on every non-Muslim. It's only for males who are capable, who are working, who have a job. Four, you see that? So if a female doesn't have to pay it, a kid doesn't have to pay it, an elderly person doesn't have to pay it, a monk who's like worshipping doesn't have to pay it. All this is shari'i laws. Ibn al-Qayyim, again, in his book, Ahkam Ahl al-Dhimma, goes in great details about it. So who pays it? A person who's capable, who's, of course, his intellect is sound, and has a job. What does that mean? Many ahadith. If that person is unemployed, if that person doesn't have money, you don't take it from him. Many ahadith, you don't force them. You don't torture them. You don't beat them for it. No. No, we don't do that. We take whatever they can give. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his time, it was 1 dinar for the entire year. Can you imagine if you pay taxes $100 a year, fixed, even if your income is 100,000? Is that a good deal? And people object, no, I don't want it. What are you speaking about? Umar ibn al-Khattab, later on, he said, you know what, it should be variable. Again, here, maqasid al-sharia. For example, in the Shafi'i madhab, it's 1 dinar fixed. But Umar ibn al-Khattab did something else, and all the other madhab, they agree with that it's variable. If someone is poor, it's 12 dirham. Someone is middle class, 24. Someone who's very rich, maximum 48 dirham, like 3 dinars maximum. $300 maximum. $3,000 maximum for the rich person. Furthermore, Umar ibn al-Khattab saw something else, and we all know this. It happened in his time. When he was walking and he saw a Jewish person, old person, and he was begging. What did he do? He said, we weren't fair to you. We took from you money, jizya, when you were young. And then when you are old, we left you. And he took money from Bayt al-Mal of the Muslims and gave it to him. So a dhimmi, this is a dhimmi. And the treasury of the Muslims, because he's incapable living with the Muslims, and he paid jizya, we take care of him. We have a covenant with them. That's not me. You don't like it? That's Umar ibn al-Khattab. Yani, and this is, again, something that he did, not me. So that's the kind of treatment we show to them. Now people debated, what is the purpose of jizya? And here scholars differed. Really, what is the intent? Some scholars said it is because they are not serving in the army, because Muslims protect them and yet they do not serve in the army. And therefore, you find in many situations, some people said, if they serve in the army, some people, not everyone, there is no yani ijma' on this. If they serve in the army, the jizya is dropped. So it's their call. You don't want to serve in the army, you pay jizya. Right? So some scholars said that. Some other scholars said, no, jizya is not for that. Ibn al-Qayyim is of that opinion. His opinion is, it is to declare sovereignty over them. It is a sign of your compliance with the state. That the rule is that you are compliant, that you're subdued to the law. I can't leave you like this is a sign of that you are going to pay jizya. You're going to accept. That's Ibn al-Qayyim's view, for example. So that's the purpose of jizya in Islam. So what I was saying is that therefore you have categories. And we said last time three categories, remember? A Muslim, a dhimmi, a non-Muslim living with the Muslims, a citizen. And a third category, a visitor, a person that comes to study, F1 visa, H1 visa. You know, person that's visiting the Muslim state, he's not a resident, he's not a citizen, he's visiting, he's staying a year. That's a musta'man. And Sharia is very lenient with them because they're just visiting. They're just passing. Again, not my words. So let's go with the crimes of, or the hudud of adultery, if you will. Two things first. Number one, the had of al-qadhf. Qadhf meaning what? Qadhf is like when you slander. Right? So when you slander, the had established in the Quran, if you slander someone, you cannot speak about the honors of sister freely like that, or brothers. You can't. And if you're going to mess up with that, and like it's proven that you said that, the had is 80 lashes. And the question is, is that established on the musta'man and the dhimmi? And the answer in that case only is yes. All madhahib said yes. If they slander a Muslim. They're slandering a Muslim. I mean, it's yes, you're non-Muslim, but you slander the Muslim. That's our law. Now, the difference happens where if he slanders a non-Muslim. Let's say a dhimmi slanders a musta'man. That's when you can find some of the madhahib, for example. In that case, they said no had. In that case, it's up to them. They deal with it, right? That's the first had of honor. The second one, which is so famous and people speak often about, is what? Adultery. What happens if a person commits adultery? What's the had for it? Now, number one, if it is a visitor, if it's a musta'man, a person living with the Muslims for 1 year, a person who had a studying in Cairo University of Engineering, he's studying there and he's not a Muslim. And this again, not my words, and he committed the act of zina, and we're going to discuss about how. Is there a had established on him? The four madhahib. Not my words. The four madhahib. No had. No had meaning what? Nothing. There is ta'zir, remember that. There is ta'zir. But the had is not established on him because he's a musta'man. I might not like it, but this is not about what I like. This, when I find the four madhahib said something, the likes of me, I won't argue much. Right? So if you're a visitor to a Muslim country, and that you're caught doing this, they tell you because they might not believe in it. Yani they don't have the same, they're doing something, right? A dhimmi, on the other hand, is different. That's where the difference happened. A dhimmi is someone living with the Muslims that agreed to abide yani, and live with their practices. Only al-madhhab al-maliki, Imam Malik is the only madhhab that said, if a dhimmi commits this act, there is the had of the Muslim is not established on him, and he is delivered to their courts, and they deal with him. The rest of the madhahib, they said, yani, except maybe with the Hanafi fiqh, with certain cases, certain differences, they said the had is established on them, on the dhimmi person. Now, the question is, when people hear this, do you know what it takes when we speak about this adultery? It's impossible. When you think about it, it's for a person to be caught doing this, what does it mean? What does it require? Four witnesses. Four witnesses that saw what? Saw the act. Not that they're together. Saw the act, the physical act. What does that mean? You know what? If somebody does something like that in public, all what it takes, if he covers himself with a blanket, I didn't see it. I saw that they're together, but I didn't see it. So for four people to see that done, what does that mean? What does that, this person is doing what? He's going outside, uncovered, and he's committing this in front of everyone. This is not okay. Is that okay? For Muslims, that is, are you crazy? You're not only doing it in the dark, you're not even caring to cover, and you want four people to see you do that, and you continue, and they see you. That is really serious business here. And therefore, I had one of my dear friends, and he's now an imam in Sacramento. He did a study because he noticed this. It is very difficult to prove this had. And he did a study which is very interesting. He said what? The very first 100 years, you know, the very first, the companions and the tabi'een, how many times this had was done? And he, according to him, and he was doing the research, he's telling me, most of them that I found is what? People confessing. It's always people confessing because it's so hard. So hard, like, you know, and he said, I found only, you know, he went through his history books and reports. It's very difficult to do, very difficult to prove. And it said most of the time, it is people coming. And that's what happened with the time of the Prophet. If you look to the seerah, on the times that this was established, how was it? You'll find people coming to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and saying what? O Prophet of Allah, I did so and so. And what? How does the Prophet read them? Had, he looks away. And they come again. Isn't that stories that we have? And they insist and they say, maybe it wasn't. Maybe it wasn't. And then remember the hadith of the woman and said, no, I did. And I have a child. Go have birth first and then come back. He didn't put her in jail. Just go. That's not me. That's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's Islam with a heart. Today when we want to apply the had, we're so eager. Go. And she comes, oh, go, you know. Suckle him, like feed him. She insisted. Same thing with a man. Same thing. You find people coming and confessing to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A general concept about hudud. We have to know this, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Idra'u al-hudud 'an al-muslimin mastata'tu." Push away the had from people, from the Muslims, as much as you can. What does that mean? If I see something, I should be trying my best not to establish the had on him. Find a way out for him. And he said, فَإِن وَجَدْتُمْ لِلْمُسْلِمْ مَخْرَجًا. If you can find an exit, that's not my words, for a Muslim out of a had, فَخَلُّ سَبِيلُ. Let him go. Let him go. فَإِنَّ الْإِمَامْ لَأَنْ يُخْطِئْ فِي الْعَفْوِ خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَنْ يُخْطِئْ فِي الْعُقُوبَةِ. For surely, a judge, a ruler, to make a mistake in pardoning is better than to make a mistake in punishment. Salah al-Din al-Ayyubi embodied this so much. He actually used to say that. You go through his seerah, Snight, this famous, he was not weak. But you see the way he was with people, how generous, how forgiving. Every time he can find a way out, khalas, go. And when people would blame him, he would quote this hadith. He would tell them, I like to be wrong. I would like to be wrong in forgiveness, rather than be right in establishing a had. Quoting the same meaning. So this concept is very important. We cannot lose this. And yani, one time people came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam arguing. You know, judge between us this and this, and I proved it on him, and they judge. And a person really, he proved that this person did something wrong, and the had has to be established on him. O Prophet of Allah, judge. He has to judge. When he's a, you have to judge, there is no question. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, fine, khalas, it's obvious, this is wrong, the had should be established on him. And then as they're walking, they look to the Prophet, and the Prophet seemed not to be happy. And then they went back, and look at them, what they're careful for. Not, I took my right. Prophet of Allah, لَكَأَنَّكَ كَرَهْتَ هَذَا. It looks like you hated this. He said, وَمَالِي لَا أَكْرَهَ هَذَا. How come I should not hate this? تعافوا الحدود بينكم. Forgive and pardon each other before you come and commit. يعني, why are you coming to me? Do forgive each other. Do not bring everything to me. Learn to forgive each other among yourself. Don't establish had on everything you see. But yet, I don't know if you see that. You see the heart? Did he said no had? He said had. But he what? Hates it. I wish it wasn't that. Many of us have a different heart. Many of us think the only way to establish Islam is through force, brute force. That's yani, against so many teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You cannot establish Islam that way. Harshness. If that's what I think, and it shows some people raise their kids that way. I have a kid. I want him to do what's good. So the moment he's about to do something wrong, how do I discipline him? If you don't stop this, I'm going to beat you up. If you don't stop this, it's time out. If you don't stop this, I'm going to take your toy. If you don't stop this, you know, and the kid, and you know, some fathers, they're really, yani, they become like a monster. Their kid is, and the kids obey. They do obey. But what their view of their father is what? A tyrant. يعني they don't feel loved at all, right? And they're obeying out of fear, out of fear, out of fear. Is this the relation you want with your son? Versus a son that all what his father he has to tell him is, if you do that, I'm not going to be pleased with you. And that shatters the heart of the son. The worst thing for that son is what? I cannot believe I did something. When a child commits something wrong, and he's terrified, my father is going to beat me up. Versus a child who does something wrong, and his heart is broken, and he's crying. Why? How will I face my father? He's going to be so disappointed. I have to apologize. I can never do this again. Please, my father, forgive me. Which one do you want? Obvious. Yes, there are some people that, يعني, they don't come except with harshness. But it shouldn't be the norm of the society. We want the other relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what, why in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, people came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knowing the had. And they were telling, I did this wrong. Please establish had on me. What does that mean? How can they be that way? I see that Allah sees me. I can't take this. I can't take it. Oh, Prophet of Allah, I can. And there is a way out. Allah is forgiving. No, I can't take it. As a matter of fact, even with the had of zina, when we speak about that, one time, this happened in Medina. There was a woman, and she's walking, and she was far away, and somebody يعني, attacked her, trying to يعني, do this, attack her honor, basically. And as he's attacking her, and like she started screaming, another person came. He saw that. He went to rescue her. And as he goes, he grabs the person, he pushes him, the person pushes him away, they fight. He starts running and the other person يعني, is after him. The woman screams, a group of people come. And she tells them and they start running. And they capture the person and they bring him. And he says, well, it's not me. It's not me. I'm the one that was defending her. I didn't do anything. And he said, no, but we caught you running. And they go to the woman. Is he the one? And she says, yes, it was him. He's the one that did that. He says, it's not me. And he said, no, we all saw you. We saw you run. You were running. And the woman said, I know for a fact, it's him. And they go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And again, there is, you can see here the outward and the inward. The outward is what? It's a case. And the case, there is proof. And the judge, when there is proof, you have to do what? He said, khalas, like, what can I do? The had has to be established on that man. As he said this word, now look at the heart. He said, no, it's not me. He said, but she said, it's you. She's sure. And they saw you running. Everything proves it. You know, like when you have a case and it's not clear, but the judgment is, you know, you look guilty. And I'm the judge. I can't say, you know what? I'm not going to judge. It's not an option. You're the judge. You have to judge. So the Prophet said, in that case, had has to be established on you outwardly. Sharia has to do the outward, right? The outward shara is outward. Outwardly, that's the case. Once he said that, the other man stood up and said, oh, Prophet of Allah, no. He was not the one that did that. It was me. I did that. That's what we want. That's what we want. And you know what the Prophet ﷺ said? He said, as for you, the one that yani, rescued the woman, he spoke well and spoke highly of him. As for you, the man was saying, it's me, I'm ready. You can establish the had on me. He said, as for you, go, Allah forgave you. What is the legal ruling here? If somebody repented, there is no had. If somebody came and repented, theoretically, there is no had. But yet you find people, they repented and they go to the Prophet and they insist. That's not our spirit today. That's not how we are. That's what's lacking. And again, we have to go through it. Four witnesses to see this act in public. How can you do that? How dare you, living among the Muslims, and you want to do that in public? This is not okay. It's not okay at all. Yet, we say that even Imam Malik, for a dhimmi, he said there is no had that's established on him. There is no had that's established on him. And I want to finish with something. I want you to see this. Do you see something here? If that person did what he did, and there is no witnesses, does Allah see him? Is it ugly? I don't know if you're with me with your heart. Do you see the essence? Do you see what's going on here? You see what Allah is saying? You do this act and I see you. You're under my eye. And you didn't have any haya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and He sees it. What's between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah forgives. Yet, you dare go and take it to the public. It's like, you know when you have a child, I have a child and may Allah protect all our children, and he starts taking drugs and he's an addict. And he comes back home. Three things can happen. One, he tells you, Baba, I can't stop, I'm wrong, I don't know what to do, I'm not a good kid, please forgive me, I keep doing this, I cannot stop. How do you react? I would love him. I would show love, I would help him, wouldn't I? What he's doing is right, is wrong. But my relation with him is what? I'll try to shelter him as much as possible. I'll try to be with him as much as possible. One. Number two, he comes back home. What's wrong then with drugs? It's okay. Why are you telling me not to take drugs? I'm fine with it. How will I feel? How will I feel towards this son of mine? I'll be very disappointed, but I will work on him. Son, please don't take drugs, right? Please. He's a level worse than the other one, but I'm still what? I want to save him. I want to save him. Right? And it's very ugly, and he debates with me. No, it's okay. And it's fine. And I'll do it. I'm telling you I'm taking drugs. You're telling me yes. Yeah, it's horrible. And he's debating with me. But imagine now, I come back home and I find this kid, and I'm letting him, I'm trying to convince him, I'm calling counselors, right? Pushing everything on him to save him. This is what I want. Wallahu yuridu an yatuba alaykum. Allah wants you back. Allah wants to grant you repentance. Allah wants the same thing. But I come back home one day, and what do I find? I find him. He brought his gang members with drugs at home, and he's sharing it with my 12 years old daughter, with my 8 years old son, and he's giving it to him and giving it to them, and they're sitting taking drugs in front of them and having a party in the house in front of me. What will I do now? What do you feel? Honestly, what do you feel inside? Now your look to him is what? Yes, I love you, but I love my other kids too. And that you dare not only be bad for yourself, go out for them. No, out of the house. So harsh, why? Can you let him inside the house? Can you let him do that? If you let him do that, it's not even hikmah. And I'll be very harsh. How dare you? How dare you go to your sister, 12 years old, and you give her drugs? How dare you go to my 8 years old? How dare you bring your friends and party in front of them? This is not, I'm not going to forgive that out of the house. This is not acceptable. This needs a severe deterrent. Similarly, you commit adultery. Allah sees it. It's ugly. Why? Especially if you're married. Why? Why do that? Why don't you get married? It's easy, and Islam makes it easy. And that's the point. Why? What made you do this? But yet I'm willing to forgive you. Especially if you're admitting. But you dare argue against it and say, what's wrong with it? There is nothing wrong with it. It's okay. And furthermore, I'm going to do it in front of everyone. And everybody must see me. And your kids must see me. And I'm going to do it on the street. Why are you punishing me? As a matter of fact, I'm going to do it and put it on the big screen. You know? For me, it is unbelievable that a person would do that and four people sees him, right? It is just... But yet, today you go to a movie and what's up there? What are you doing to people? That's not okay. It's not okay. What are you doing to my heart? It's not okay to show that to people. It's not okay at all. You dare put it on the big screen and let and people tell you, so what? Nothing happens. Yeah, because you have a girlfriend. Come and speak to the young kid, which is 18 years old, who doesn't have a girlfriend. Tell me if that affects him. Tells me if the way you're dressed and the way you're behaving and what you're doing outside, the reason it's not affecting you, because you're already in the mud. I'm sorry to say that. But for those of us, if I'm in a Muslim nation and we are trying to purify our own heart, that affects me. I'm trying to be straight. Especially if I'm young, 16, 15, 17, I can't get married yet. And all the desires are within me and I'm trying to be straight. You think looking on those things is not going to affect me? And I'm a weak person? You dare show it in public? You need a deterrent. In that case, now you understand why it's severe. That is destructive. It is destructive. You look, What is the consequences of it? What happens to the families as a result of it? No families. You don't believe me? Go to Europe. The United States is on the same track. Europe, it's even, yani they don't even rate those movies. And they put those pictures in public. What's wrong? They don't see anything wrong. Kids can see it. There is no problem with that. Look to the family structure in Europe. There is no family structure left. It's destroyed. 70% of people here, the husbands and wives cheating on each other. As I told you, 40% of children, single mother. What will happen? The family structure is destroyed and the family is the nucleus. This is so destructive. This is why it's so dangerous. Yani this act in Islam is viewed so dangerous because it threatens family. So you're not free to go and wander and do whatever you want and the consequences of it. This is not freedom. And for sisters, you're not that cheap, for God's sake. Oftentimes, I give an example that when we want, you have a car and you want to sell it. You know when you have a car and somebody comes and tells you, I want your car. But you know, I'm not sure yet. Can I try it? Let me try it. And he takes it. Let me go to work with it. I need to try it. I need to go to Arizona and back with it so I make sure it's good with the weather. And let me have it for 2 years to make sure that it's okay. And then after 3 years, here is your keys. It's not good enough. Does this work? What are you speaking about? And yet people, I'm so afraid to get married. He might not be the right guy for me. So to find out, what should I do? I go live with him, spend my life with him, spend 3 years, and alhamdulillah, at the end of the 3 years, thank God he was not the right guy for me. After what? After what? What have you done to yourself? Not only outwardly, emotionally. We all know when you go through such kind of a relation, you avoided what? Marriage and a divorce? Marriage is easy, divorce is also easy. Yani, divorce is not something light, but it's available. We have a joke in Egypt about two guys that went and they saw something on the ground, and one of them, this is chocolate, and said, nah, this was a dog passing here, and you know, that's his. No, it's chocolate. No, it's a dog. No. And one of them said, okay, here, let me taste it. It's a dog. Thank God we didn't step on it. Thank God you didn't step on it. 3 years you live with a person, and thank God I didn't marry him. What are you doing? And you don't treat your car that way. You don't treat your house that way. You treat your daughter that way. What kind of mind is this? This is where, again, you can't speak logic with such kind. You don't see it's ugly? Are you kidding? There is something wrong with the heart. It can't be. This is the only explanation. This is so ugly. It's obvious ugly. It's obvious. And that's why Islam, again, this hadd of zina, and look at this. The punishment for killing, if somebody killed a person, how many witnesses do you need? Two. Right? If somebody commits zina, how many witnesses do you need? You know what Allah just, you know what the meaning of, from a Shari'i perspective, you know what's the meaning here? Allah's making it more hard to, you understand? Killing is so serious. That's why two is enough, because killing you can't be on the go. But with zina, Allah made it so hard. So hard. Four witnesses. Four. And yet you want to be seen doing that and four witnesses on top of it. And you think it's okay. If you're living in a Muslim nation, if you're living in the West, if it's not a Muslim nation, it's up to you. Again, Shara, I can't do anything. It's wrong. And I'm going to tell you it's wrong. Living here, I still tell them this is haram. Don't date. Sisters, do not date. It's wrong. Don't dress that way. It's wrong. I can say that. But if they do not see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if the heart is not connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course it's going to see this as ugly. They will ban niqab. Right? You know what I mean? Niqab is banned. It's ugly. How dare you? But a movie that this happens in, oh, it's freedom. They can, an actor and an actress can do this and it's okay. It's their right. And this, her wearing niqab is ugly. Her wearing hijab is ugly. What an irony. What an irony. And what can we say? And this is again, if you return back to the Quran, you find why the spiritual discourse is necessary. It is not about logic, as people say. It is not logic. It's about a heart that's blind, that sees good as ugly and ugly as good. And that's mentioned in the Quran. As a matter of fact, and I finish with this, this is what the shaitan swore he will do. You know, we believe in shaitan. And he swore. قَالَ فَبِعِزَّتِكَ لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ He swore, and this is a declaration, by your might, by Allah's izzah, I am going to make all of them fall into غَي. And this word غَي he used, what does it mean? You know what غَي means? It is not that he's going to tell you, this is ugly, do it. غَي, I'm going to make what's ugly look nice, and what's nice look ugly. I'm going to confuse them, into such an extent, I'm going to decorate the ugly thing for them that they see it nice and they do it. So their calibration of the heart is messed up. So they look and they do what's wrong and they see it as nice. And they look to what's right and they see it as wrong. The opposite of it is rushd. The word used in the Quran, rushd. Rushd in the Quran, ولكن الله حبب إليكم الإيمان وزينه في قلوبكم وكره إليكم الكفر والفسوق والعصيان أولئك هم الراشدون. It's a very nice way to end this. يعني Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the one that made belief beloved to you and made decorated in your heart. As a Muslim, salah is beautiful, hijab is beautiful, a beard is beautiful. As a Muslim, that's why I see it this way. It's nice, it's lovely, it looks so nice, it's beautiful. وكره إليكم الكفر والفسوق والعصيان. Disobedience, kufr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, disbelief for a believer, it's ugly. It's trash. And Allah says, those are people of rushd. How can I establish rushd? One verse in the Quran. وَمَنْ أَسْلَمَ فَأُولَئِكَ تَحَرَّوا رَشَدًا Surah Al-Jinn. قُلْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ أَنَّهُ اسْتَمَعَ نَفَرٌ مِّنَ الْجِنِّ فَقَالُوا إِنَّا سَمِعْنَا قُرْآنًا عَجَبًا يَهْدِي إِلَى الرُّشْدِ فَآمَنَّا بِهِ When the jinn, they said that, we heard an amazing Quran that guides to rushd. And Allah in Surah Al-Jinn later says, مَنْ أَسْلَمَ Whoever submits, أُولَئِكَ تَحَرَّوا رَشَدًا In the beginning, I say, you know what? No, this looks nice to me. Dating is okay. I don't see it as bad. Hijab looks bad for me. But man aslama, when I say, you know what, it's me. It's my hawa. If that's from Allah, I submit. I submit to Allah. You say that's ugly, it's ugly. That's good, it's good. I submit. The consequences of it, the heart changes. And the heart is clean. And all of a sudden, the same person will be saying, how on earth did I see this as ugly and this is good? And the heart, he becomes from the Rashidin. People that see what right as right, and therefore it's easy to follow. And what is ugly and bad as ugly and bad, and therefore it is very easy for them to avoid it. That's what we want. That's rushd. And I think I'll stop here. The topic is intense, and I might have said something that, number one, I might be wrong in. Please don't be offended. Number two, I might have said something, and that's very common, that you misunderstood. Number three, I might have said something that's out of context. It's also possible, right? So please forgive me if I said anything wrong. If you heard something that you don't like, discuss it with me. And again, it's not. I try as much as possible in this topic. It's not my opinions. I can get you the sources of everything I said, where I got it from, whether it's Ibn al-Qayyim, the great Sheikh al-Bouti in his book, whether it's Ibn Ashur, whether it's Al-Shatibi, Al-Ghazali, the four madhahib, I can show you the references. So if you have any issues, don't let it simmer in your heart. And some people do not like the fact that Sharia is easy. And Sharia is easy. And Allah said it in the Quran. Some people, it should be harsh. And I understand that that's commendable. If it's on me, I can be harsh with me. But when it's with others, I should be easy. How do I do that practically? If I want to ask, you ask a sheikh, you go to a sheikh in a public, ya sheikh, what's the fatwa of this? He has to give you the fatwa that's really the fatwa, the easy fatwa. If you really want something for me, and this is what I personally do, by the way, and then I go to the same sheikh and tell him, ya sheikh, he speaks this and tell him, ya sheikh, what do you do? See the difference? It's not what do you do? Halal meat, halal haram, ya sheikh, yes. What do you do? So you might find the sheikh that tells you it's halal, halal, you can eat. And they tell him, what do you do? Well, I don't eat it. Thank you. That's what I want. But I apply this to me. Right? And yes, I can be very harsh with you, if you want, on yourself. And yes, I can be very harsh. Where is your dhikr? Where is your nawafil? You want to, many people want to be harsh with the society. The Muslims are not this. The ruler is not this. This is not that. Excuse me. I want to be harsh. I'll be on you. Where is your nawafil? Where is prayers the last third of the night? Why aren't you memorizing Quran? Why do you drink coke? You think that's okay? It's not okay. It's mafsada. You want me to be harsh with you, don't you? Can I say then it's haram? No. But you want harshness? Some people are like that. And the Prophet showed us this with the likes of Abu Dharr. And he would go to them and tell them to take the, you know, be, but be careful. Be careful. There is a difference between me and the rest of people. If I want something for me, you ask for you. Ya Sheikh, tell me, what do you do? You will receive a different answer in that case. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر جزاكم الله كل خير